Another area where I think technology-mediated environments can make a huge difference is an area that I want to call recursive feedback. And I want to use that phrase instead of assessment or instead of testing, but actually it's a business of replacing the same stuff or doing the same stuff in a different kind of way. So testing has always been about building feedback systems. So you do your work for a semester or a year, and at the end of the year you get a report card or a set of scores or a set of grades which tells you how well you've done. So it's a kind of feedback on your learning. It's a feedback mechanism. Now, conventional assessment is very much focused on what is technically called summative assessment. So you do a bit of learning and you come along and you do a test or an assessment which essentially tells you what you've remembered. I mean, that's more than anything else, that's what it's about. It might actually prove that you can operationalize certain things, you've been given certain algorithmic things to do, certain formulaic things to do, and you can operationalize those things in the form of correct answers. But in a way, what you're remembering there is routine. So you either remember facts, you remember definitions or concepts, or you remember routines. And it happens at the end, and it's retrospective. Now, I think one of the profound implications of these new technology-mediated environments is to broaden the scope of assessment and to change its orientation. And I want to call that new orientation recursive feedback. Now, of course, the argument we're making about affordances is that you can do conventional testing in these spaces in the same way. So let me tell you examples of that that kind of a testing. You know, at the end of the semester, you might do an online test instead of a pen and paper test. And it might have item-based questions in it which show what you've remembered from the year. And it may be a much more efficient thing than having to mark pen and paper assessments and so on. Or at the end of the semester, there are now technologies which are called automated assessment technologies. So you might do an automated writing assessment at the end of the semester, which uses natural language processing techniques to analyse how well you can write. You've been working on writing for a year, and this gives you a kind of a score. So there are these technologies now which reproduce perfectly, and in fact are more efficient about the traditional mechanism of summative assessment and the traditional objectives of summative assessment around routines, capacities, memory, and all those kinds of things. Now, that's not interesting in a way. It's not as interesting anyhow as what new things we might be able to do. And one of the things we've always done pretty badly in education is what's called formative assessment, which is on-the-fly responses which evaluate the work you've done in a way which helps you improve your work. So in other words, the classic differentiation is summative assessment is assessment of learning, formative assessment is assessment for learning. Okay, now the thing is that the mechanics of giving a lot of formative assessment is an awful lot of work for the teacher. And one of the issues, one of the reasons why it's never been very successful is just that. It's just not practicable. We've wanted to do it historically in education. We've always known it's important. But for the teacher to give everybody in their class enough feedback to be useful for the work they do next in 5 minutes or the next day, that's just, it's pretty well impossible. So what I'm interested in about in these e-learning environments is building up the strength of formative assessment. How can we actually build up a formative assessment as a recursive feedback system? So in a way, you know, the score you get at the end of the semester, the grade, the mark you get, it's not a very recursive system. It's just a kind of a moral lesson. Okay, next year you work harder. Okay, that's not terribly recursive. What I mean by recursive is feedback loops. So you get a bit of feedback and incrementally you do something with your work, and then you get a bit more feedback, and incrementally you do something with your work, and your work is continuously improving as a result of these feedback loops. So how might we be able to use e-learning environments to do that? That's a really important question. So I've got several answers to that. One answer is machine feedback is getting better. So now I'll give you a couple of examples of machine feedback, but also What I'm going to get to in a moment is machine-mediated human feedback, but let's just deal with machine feedback first. So firstly, even conventional item-based testing in these environments can be pretty sophisticated, and it can be on the fly. You're constantly doing small item-based assessments. In the work that I do, I want to call these surveys. I want to call these knowledge surveys. I don't want to even call them assessments, because in fact we're using techniques from a domain of academic activity which I would call survey psychometrics. So underneath it, we're using a technique called survey psychometrics. So we're in the class now. We do a small item-based test, and that item-based test can be computer adaptive. I don't have time to explain in detail what computer adaptive testing is, but in very general terms, what computer adaptive testing is that you give an answer to a question and you don't get it right, and therefore the next question becomes easier until you reach a point where the questions are just right for you, where you're getting a good mix of them right and wrong, and they're just at your knowledge level and so on. So that's computer adaptive testing based on item banks, but it means that you're in a class and all the students are doing the same test, but they're actually doing different tests which are being constantly recalibrated to their learning ability. So that means that the teacher can know, look, this student's up to that, this student's up to that. It gives them immediate feedback around the next lot of instructional techniques. The other technology around survey psychometrics is diagnostic testing. So what we do is we identify particular areas of subject matter in what's being learned, and we can identify which areas the student is already competent in and the areas where they need to learn more. So that's one form of very sophisticated machine feedback, where you could have these little routines, these item-based surveys in place, and be implementing them all the time rather than at the end of the semester or at the end of the year, and using that to adapt and customise instruction for particular students or the whole class. Very, very useful information for the teacher, but also useful information which can be fed back to the student, like immediately tell them what the right or wrong answer is and get them to work around, you know, what the issues were in terms of the answer that they chose. So that's one example of a kind of machine feedback. The other area which is developing quite dramatically and quite radically is an area called natural language processing. And we're not there yet, but we at the University of Illinois, some other researchers who work in this area of what's called computational linguistics or natural language processing, I think we're not far off a point where we can detect information structures in text, where we can detect argument in text, and give useful feedback, machine feedback on students' work. So already in the research work that I'm doing, we're giving feedback which is, you know, it's not comprehensive, it's not perfect, it's useful, it's something. But these technologies are moving on very fast. You'll notice that I've got some educational favourites in the slides, in the images here, which are just in the background, and I want to sort of mention them to you. Heroes in terms of the world of information technologies, communication, learning, and so on. And the person in this picture is a very famous Bengali poet by the name of Tagore. I've actually got a quite nice U of I story. It's incredible that a Bengali poet should win the Nobel Prize, because he wrote exclusively in Bengali, which is a relatively, it's not Spanish, and it's not Chinese, and it's certainly not English. And he won the Nobel Prize in 1913. In fact, his son was studying agriculture at the University of Illinois, and he came here to visit his son, the University of Illinois, in 1913, and when the prize was announced, he was here at the University of Illinois. So that's a rather nice story. Now, why is he important in educational terms? Well, he was very interested in practical education for Bengali farmers. Traditionally, farmers in Bengal would not have been had access to formal education, but he was interested in how one produces grounded experiential education which is relevant to the Indian village. So what he did is he built a school, he thought a lot about these educational issues, and if John Dewey in the US was thinking about the idea of education experience, experiential learning, learning which is grounded in things that are necessary for everyday life, Tagore was the Indian equivalent of that, thinking about that in relation to village life in India. So he's an incredibly interesting person in education, and there in the image you can see him meeting with Mahatma Gandhi.